Hey there folks, Gary Bradley here from Creative Frontiers, and in this video I'm going to show you how you can create scatter brushes inside of Illustrator. If this is your first time visiting and you want to learn best practice techniques to create killer artwork, then start now by subscribing and clicking the bell so you don't miss a thing. Now scatter brushes are ideal for, well, this kind of thing really, where I want to put some stars in the sky. It would be really tedious to have to create separate elements of stars and copy them around and arrange them when I can actually run them through a brush on a path. In this example, we're going to start off with a plain old star. We're going to modify its appearance and then turn it into a scatter brush. And then we'll look at how we can change the properties of that brush as well. So without further ado, I will dive in. So this is my file here, and I'm going to go to the window menu and then open up the brushes panel where all the work will be done really. It has the same keyboard shortcut as Adobe Photoshop as well, which is F5. And then from here, you'll see that this is pretty much what you'll get these days inside of Illustrator, which is a handful of brushes of different types. So you could get up and running and you could try those. So as I say, most of these are based on vector artwork inside of Illustrator. Some of them, in the case here, this leather seam, that started out life as a pixel-based piece of artwork. And essentially a brush is artwork that you run through or along a path. Ours is going to be a star, so we do, of course, in the tools panel have a perfect tool for that, which is the star tool. So if I pick up my zoom tool, I'm going to zoom in just to the side of the artboard in here. I'm going to zoom in quite high, the zoom level, because I'm going to make a really small star. So I'm going to click and hold down on the rectangle tool in the tools panel, reveal the pop-out menu, and then choose the star tool from there. So that really is the appearance of the star that you get. If I click and hold down the mouse and drag out, that's what you get, a five-pointed star. You could also, if you want to change the appearance of this, you could hold down the Alt key and that would give you kind of a more equally weighted star in there. If I take my finger off the Alt key, of course, you go back to the default appearance in there, which is kind of like a cherished badge. If I tap the Up cursor key, you can add more points. You can also tap the Down cursor key to reduce the number of points as well. But if I let go of the left mouse button now, that's pretty much the default appearance for a star inside of Illustrator. That's not quite what we want. So I want to create something slightly different. Now, I've still got the star tool active, but if I hover my cursor somewhere over the image window, right next to the previous one, and then left click, you'll get the star dialog box. So it will show you the previous settings that I have here with my selected star and the last thing that I made. So you've got what's called radius 1 and radius 2, and then you've got the number of points. So as you can see with our selected star in here, I made it with a radius 1, which are the outside points of the star, of 50 pixels there or thereabouts, and then radius 2 are the little points on the inside of the star in there. So you can modify these in the dialog box however you want in there. So I'm actually going to make this really, really small. So I'm going to set radius 1 in there to be 4 pixels, really super small. So we want tiny stars in the sky. And then radius 2, which where the anchor points are on the inside of this star, are going to be 0.7 pixels. And then I'm going to change the points in here from 5 to 4. When I click OK, we get a really teeny tiny star. So if I pick up a keyboard shortcut of Command and Plus and zoom in there, that's what we get. So you see the difference? It still has the default appearance inside of Illustrator as well as a fill of white and a stroke of black. So if I go to the window menu, go down the list and choose swatches. From here then, I will make sure that my stroke appearance is active and then remove the stroke, leaving with just a plain old brilliant white star in there for the fill, like so. And then I will right click and choose to close down my swatches panel. And then at this point, what I would suggest is I switch to my selection tool, and you could click and drag and you could drop that in there like so to create a new brush. You'll see the plus icon next to my cursor indicating that I will create something new in the brushes panel. Or if I just take my cursor away from there, let go, but with it still selected, the base artwork to create your brush, you can go to the bottom and you can left click on new brush. Illustrator will then say to you, okay, these are the types of brushes you can make with a selected artwork. You've got calligraphic, scatter, art, bristle, and pattern brush. In this case, we're going to use scatter. Now, I am going to click OK. So it will create a copy, or it will use the original artwork as the basis for this brush. It won't affect the original artwork. It just uses it as a reference material. Now, when you get to this dialog box, obviously, we don't have a brush stroke of this artwork applied in here. So what I tend to do is, the name will be highlighted there by default. So to name this, I'm going to call this Starry. And then quite literally, I just click OK and I make the star in there. And you can see that if I hover my cursor over there, that's the name of my Starry brush in there. You get a square thumbnail for it. because the artwork is white, it's set against a white thumbnail in there. You won't be able to see that. If you did want to see a preview of very bright artwork for the thumbnails for brushes, you'll have to press Command and K or Control K on a PC, then go to user interface, and you'll have to change the UI brightness to something darker. And when it's set to a darker one, or the darkest one, you'll then see that you get a slightly darker colored background for the previews in there. So if you don't see the preview of your artwork and it's very light, that's how you can solve it. Now, as with all my tutorials, I tend to set my screen brightness brighter in here so you can see my cursor better, and then I'll click OK. So from here then, we need to actually create a brush stroke to put this artwork onto. So I'll go to View and then choose Fit Art Body Window. And then this is star over here. It's not affected. It's not linked to the brush artwork. So I'm going to deactivate it. And then I'm going to go to my tools panel and hover over and click on the paintbrush tool. Now it's got a B key on the keyboard for short. That's the same as the Photoshop brush tool. So you can click on the brush tool in there. I would suggest before you start using the brush tool, double left click on the tool's thumbnail to bring up the paintbrush tool options, because this works very much like the pencil tool in that when you click and drag with this tool to use it, you're going to draw a path. It will match your hand gestures. So in this case, it will usually be set to the middle. I don't want my brush to match, or the path to match my hand gestures very, very accurate. I'm going to get a very complex path. It's going to be harder to edit. If it's set to the default of the middle in there, somewhere in between, I might find I still get a very complicated path. I want a nice, long, smooth, sweeping path. So that's why you can just drag across there or click to where it reads smooth. And I'll get a very simple, low anchor point count path. And then I'll click OK. And from here then, you have to tell Illustrator which brush you want to use. And it is already active in here, but you can left click and you get this little black outline around the brush that you're going to use. I'll move that to the side, and then starting higher up in the sky, I'm going to start at the top up here. I'm going to click and hold down the mouse, keep it held down, and drag across here like so, just going from side to side to create my path, and then let go of the mouse. And we get this, which doesn't look like a normal starry sky. So what Illustrator does for your brushes is it takes the original artwork and then it just copies it along your path. We do need to edit this, and this is why you really need to see what the brush looks like on a path before you edit its properties. So I'll tap the V key in the keyboard to switch to the selection tool. You don't have to have the brush stroke active in there. And just to show you, if I select it, you can see the anchor points in here. So nice and simple. If I go to View and choose Outline, there's nothing on there. It's just an appearance as the brush stroke. So the brush artwork is a virtual appearance that just runs through your path. View and then Preview. And then from here, I'm going to click away from the path, hover my cursor over the starry brush thumbnail and double left click. That will then take me back to the same set of options in here. So if I just drag this to the side here, we can see then a preview of the artwork behind, as long as the preview checkbox is turned on, of course. And then we have a series of drop-down menus. You can alter the variation of the size, the spacing, the scatter, and the rotation. I'm going to, because the nature of what we're dealing with here, I'm going to alter the first three. I'm not going to rotate these stars, but that is something you could do as well, of course. So under size, I'm going to click on the drop-down menu. We have in here, amongst all the options, you've got fixed all the way through to things like stylus wheel, tilt. So from pressure down to rotation, these really are geared towards a graphics tablet and pen, such as a Wacom tablet. And depending on what you do in terms of the pen pressure and the tilt or the bearing of the pen on the graphics tablet, it will alter these options. Now, if you don't have a graphics tablet, then you can just use the top two in here. So we already see what fixed does. It's not really giving us what we want. So I'm going to choose random. And to be honest, for a scatter brush, it's what I tend to use anyway. You get really good results from it. So if I click on random from the drop-down menu, from here then, under size, you've got two sets of sliders with percentages assigned to them. So I would say, to make life easier, I set all of these left-hand sliders to be the minimum values and the ones on the right-hand side to be the maximum values. So if I want to alter the size of my stars, I can click and drag. I can drag these. I can make my stars look really big. So they could go from the original size of the star 100% all the way up to 852%. Now, I don't want my stars to look that big. So I'm going to drag that down a little bit in there. I'm going to make some of the stars a little bit bigger in there. So say 300%. Ish. And then I'll go to the slider on the left hand side, and I'll set this to be the minimum size of what my stars could be. So I'm going to set this to, or 25% in there. I think actually the minimum is 10%. Yeah, 10% in there is the minimum you can go to. And if I just drag that little bit higher in there, let's go for 15% in this case. You can always come back in here and edit these at any time. And then we'll come to spacing. So spacing, I'll change it from fixed to random. And again, I'll use this slider over here so we can have a minimum amount of space between them. So how much of a gap do you want between each start? We could have, in this case, between a 32% space, or we could go for a bigger space between them and really space them out if we wish to. So I might leave it something like this for now. And then the final one I'll edit is scattering. So this is the thing that will move the stars further away from the path. And again, if I click on the drop-down menu, I'll choose random. And then from here, notice that obviously there is no movement away from the path for either one of these. But as soon as I drag this slider towards the left-hand side, you'll see that the stars start to move apart or move away from the path. Now, the way that it works is you might notice if I just drag this back in here, keep moving it, you'll notice that some move up and some move down. That's because in the case of where I started, which was up here, and I dragged the mouse along here, this is dragged from right over to left. Stars start moving up above the path. When I then create a curve around here and then dragged it in the opposite direction, these stars will actually start to move a lower down away from the path in there. So I've got, you know, a nice amount of scattering in there. I could even scatter that even further. In fact, I'm going to go for the maximum, which is a minus 1000 in there. I'll go to the maximum distance that I want them scattered from the path, and you'll see now they start to scatter in both directions, both higher and lower from the path in there. So with that done, again, it depends what you're going to create, but I'm happy with those being scattered to the minimum and absolute maximum in there. As I say, I'm not going to rotate those stars and leave them set to the same orientation that they're at in here. I might think that actually some of those stars look a little bit big. I might go to the maximum size in there and just pull that back a touch, like so. So yeah, I'm happy with some of those. That's pretty good. When I'm done, I'll go down to the bottom, click OK. Illustrator will then say to me, "Oh, hang on a minute, you've applied this brush to certain paths in the document. Do you want to keep those paths looking the way they look now, or do you want to update those paths with the brush starry applied to them with the new settings?" You can do whatever you want to really in here. I'm going to choose apply these edits to the strokes that have been added to the document. And you'll see there they stay the same because they've been updated in the preview. So you can go back, you can select your path. If you don't like the arrangement of the stars, you can always select the path in question, go back and just left click once on starry, whichever brush it is, and you'll get a different version of those stars. Just keep a single left click and you get different rendition of what those stars look like. It's just a random arrangement in there. So I'm fairly happy with that one. I could even then go back to my paintbrush tool. So I'll click away from the path, go back to my paintbrush tool, and then fill in some of these gaps in here that I've got because the scattering didn't quite fill everything out. I'm going to hover my cursor again over this region here, click and drag through here, down here, just sort of fill in these gaps in like so. And then because I still had the starry brush active, it's applied that automatically in there. So I'll go back to my selection tool. If you want to vary these a little bit further, you could hover over one of the paths, left click on it. I could then go to, say, for example, window, go down to transparency. And in the transparency dialog box in here, I can change the opacity. So if I wanted to, I could click on the little pop out in there, drag that and lower the opacity of some of those stars. So again, you could vary some of them to make them look like they're further away, some closer. And then I can just move that to the side and then click away from the artwork and see what I get. So you could add more stars in there. You could fill it as much as you want, but that essentially is how you create a scatter brush inside of Illustrator, folks. We started off with a basic shape of the star. We altered its properties to make it a four-pointed star. We then added that to the brushes panel. And as I say, it would be better really to create whatever. It doesn't have to be accurate, but just draw a brush stroke on screen to see what the scatter brush looks like. And then once you've created that path, you can go back to the brushes panel, double click on your brush icon in there and alter its properties to create, for example, as we've done here, random size, random spacing and random scattering as well. As always, folks, if you've enjoyed the video, please give it a thumbs up to help the channel. You can always subscribe to the channel as well. And until next time, farewell, folks.